First, a few thoughts about missing opportunities and things that are gone. Throughout the work that I've done, over many years and in many different capacities, there have been cases where I've come up against collections or piles of material, and where I can, I quote-unquote save them. That is, if they are sitting waiting to be destroyed, I'll step in, connect people with stuff, and then in some way ensure it lives on for at least a little while longer. But that can't happen every time. I'm not told about it, I don't have the capacity at the time, or I don't recognize how at risk something is. That's just the nature of life. I mention this because every once in a while I see people talk about being concerned or angry or furious when it turns out something unique or even not unique was thrown out, and that's just how things are going to go. What makes items rare is that they weren't often recognized as being interesting, and all the other copies were removed. What makes finding something rare so special is the beautiful coincidence of something precious meeting the person who recognizes it as such. That's what we should focus on. That's what should make us happy. And coming to terms with the transience of life and the amount of bad luck and bad opportunity that rises should really be what we concentrate on, and the wonder that happens every day because of it. This is Jason Scott Talks His Way Out of It, a podcast about technology, history, and getting myself out of debt. Thanks to Daniel Boyd, William Hearn, and the hundreds of other supporters on Patreon and elsewhere who have been supporting me and helping me get out of debt. I'm sure if I go through my mail spools, I'll figure out how I first found out about John Sheetz. I was working on the BBS documentary, and I had cast my net ridiculously wide. If somebody did anything that touched any sort of data going over any sort of medium, I was pretty open to the idea of an interview and finding some way to fit them into the narrative I was building. My documentary was going to go in many directions and have as many episodes as needed, so if somebody thought they might be a part of it, I was going to give them that chance. Sometimes this worked out okay, sometimes it didn't work out at all, and sometimes it worked out in ways I couldn't have imagined. I found out that there had been something before BBSs, and in many ways had a lot of the same attributes and went through a number of the same innovations that we saw a decade or two later. I'm speaking about ham radio, and specifically about RTTY art. If you've seen the BBS documentary, you've seen John Sheetz. He's the old man at the beginning of the art scene episode. In it, John is talking about RTTY art, or remote teletype art, digging into the history and the different aspects of RTTY and RTTY art. Was one of the most rewarding dives I ever took in doing my research. In very short, compact form, RTTY enabled you to take a teletype-like experience and transmit it over the airwaves to others. It was like typing into the air. You only had capital letters, and the transfer rate was not great. Additionally, if someone spoke or in other ways made noise on this, it would ruin the transmission. But the advantage was that a whole bunch of people could be listening in and transfer this signal back into printed letters. This in itself would be relatively interesting, perhaps having some sort of automated system send news transmissions over the radio airwaves, enabling you to communicate across the world for a pretty inexpensive price. But besides that was the ability to create remote teletype art. By this I mean taking letters and numbers, forming them into some sort of art, assuming a proportional font, and then creating this art by hand, recording it being done, and then transmitting it to others. In the 60s, there was a RTTY art contest run by Don Royer, where every month people could enter the contest, and one would be judged the winner and made available to as many people as possible. This contest went well into the 70s, and after Don Royer died, it was taken over by John Sheetz. This was the very basic information that I had when I traveled to New Jersey to interview Mr. Sheetz. He had been a Bell Systems engineer all of his life, and he had retired a few years earlier, but still had a number of artifacts and pieces across his life. Now, when I was interviewing him, it was almost 100% about RTTY art, and he thought I was wasting my time. He didn't know what this documentary was about, why this long-haired kid was setting up this camera to record all this stuff about him, and he thought the questions were all over the place. But he was patient with me, and we set up in his living room and recorded about 1 hour worth of discussion. There's a certain kind of person who has sat in front of my camera where I can tell they don't get interviewed all that often. And those folks tend to not look at the camera or look at the camera and nothing else, and also are very quick to get out of their seat to go get something for me and bring it back, unaware that there's some tape recording and that we're losing footage. John did that a number of times. He would get up, bolt over to a part of his house, pick up a part, and then show it to me. But outside of the somewhat clumsy interview, John Sheetz had a wealth of information for me. Just on RTTY art itself, he was telling me memories of things that had happened 30 or 40 years previously. He would talk about how every Sunday night was the big time for transferring RTTY art. So every Sunday, somebody would announce a new piece of art, everybody would press record, and they would all record this hot new art being transferred over the airwaves on a Sunday night. Almost immediately, John Sheetz, who was 80 years old, explained to me how he was a latecomer, how the stuff that he was doing in the 60s was decades after the real art was being done. He started telling me about typewriter art. There were a whole bunch of artists, certainly from the late 1800s, going into the 1910s and 1920s, who were using typewriters, actual, regular, hit everything, no recording of it, no playback typewriters, to make all sorts of art. Landscapes, portraits, cartoons, greeting cards, by typing them in, one key at a time, on an old typewriter. And those folks had gotten very good at them, indeed. One of the advantages of a typewriter is that because you're working off a roller with a piece of paper in it, there are no limits to how you're going to put those letters on that page. So there were entire styles of typewriter art where they would move the roller back and forth and move the paper up and down to be able to do some incredibly complicated artwork. There's books of these out there, rare but scanned, that show you a breathtaking artistry being done in these manual typewriters a century ago. On the floor of his living room, John Sheetz had pulled out, for me, hundreds upon hundreds of RTTY art artworks. One of them was of The Last Supper, and that was what had gotten us on the typewriter discussion, because he believed that while it was a 1960s Last Supper, it was in fact a duplicate of a 1930s typewriter art. So people were upgrading and updating art done in the 30s to make it work with technology of the 60s. And that art was the art that I saw when I was logging on to bulletin board systems in the 1980s and they were being transferred in text file sections. Because a lot of good art is just good art. The medium doesn't matter. Beyond all the text files of fiction and technology, there were people who were putting up these very old remote teletype artworks, converting them to ASCII, and then uploading them as if they were just another thing to look at. It was only in the expanse of time and downloading thousands upon thousands of text files that I could trace back some of these pieces of work. And John Sheetz had kept all of it. All of the artwork that he had done on the side, working on the RTTY Art contest and taking it over for Don after Don had died, and ensuring that somebody with a digital camera in 2002 would record an interview with him. RTTY Art is beautiful. It has a very special quality to it because it was made in a world without 4K displays and instantaneous transfer. It was done at a time when the transfer rate could be maybe 50 or 100 characters per second, meaning that you were committing in time for this thing to come across the airwaves to your home or your office. You were hoping there'd be no data corruption. You might have to step in afterwards, do a little bit of text surgery to make things work again. You were playing a part in the slow transfer of something truly timeless. And I say timeless because I've looked at these works across the years, from my teenage years all the way to now, and they've never stopped being as compelling as the first time I saw them. In their most fundamental form, RTTY Art just uses letters and numbers, maybe punctuation marks, creating a easily transferable, easily printable on screen or paper piece of artwork. But everybody innovates everywhere. So in the RTTY Art world, there was the possibility of not entering at the end of a line. If you did that, a teletype would not advance the paper one line, but could get a carriage return and go back to the front of the line. You could then print again. What that meant was you could get shades far beyond what you would get with a single character. By putting several letters over each other, you could get black squares, half shading, half tone, far beyond what any printer otherwise would have been capable. If it all worked, if nothing went wrong, it would fall together into a near photorealistic piece of art. And if that wasn't enough, sometimes they would make the art so that it worked across multiple pieces of paper. In other words, you would have four columns in the artwork, and it was your job, after everything had printed out, to cut strips on the left and the right of the printer paper so you could tape them together and the image would continue all the way across, producing a 300, 500 column piece of art. I have an incredibly strong memory of trying this out in my teens, printing things out on my Epson MX-80 printer and then cutting all of those pieces of paper close enough that I could tape it together and put it on my wall. I had a photograph of an astronaut on the moon printed in Epson MX-80 font in my bedroom for at least 2 years. And I can attest, if you tape one of those on the wall of your bedroom over your heating elements, it will eventually fade away. Naturally, as time went on, people wrote programs to simulate a teletype printing, to implement Overstrike, and take in all the unique weirdness of the printing commands. Something about it, though, is not quite the same for me. There was something about standing over John Sheetz, who was on his knees, pawing through all of these different pieces of paper and showing them to me, that felt like I was a witness to a transfer of knowledge, a transfer of heart, a transfer of meaning. But like I said at the beginning of this episode, one can't get hung up on things disappearing. John Sheetz and I shook hands, I went off, and during my editing process, I found out he had died. I put up his full interview on the Internet Archive, and I continued to work on the Art Scene episode, including him at the beginning, talking about the art scene of RTTY in the 1960s, and saying that he thought there'd never be anything like it again. I asked around about some of the artifacts from his home. After he had died, I found out that some engineers had come over and the family had given them all sorts of pieces of things that John had collected over the years related to the Bell Labs. I know that there were pieces of teletype that got turned into repair, but I'm honestly unsure whatever happened to those reams upon reams of printer paper with RTTY Art on it. Before anybody gets too sad, too furious, too powerless, let me say that almost all of that art has ended up online. There's a site called RTTY.com. They have an incredible collection of this artwork going through all of the years, and I suspect that if it isn't complete, it's nearly so. I made a copy of it for textfiles.com. It's in the Art Scene collection. I know that others have it on their websites. Since it compresses so beautifully, it's been transferred around everywhere. You do not need to worry. The hundreds upon hundreds of artworks done by a group of anonymous and non-anonymous artists looked over by Don and John over the years, it has been preserved. But beyond the preservation, I like to think that part of why it got preserved was because it speaks so well for itself. The artwork in these RTTY pieces harkens back, in some cases, centuries to the Renaissance paintings they would act like, or cartoons that were universally beloved, or landscapes that just felt great in a homemade sort of way. They are fundamentally and intrinsically living artwork. I don't keep logs and statistics as to how many people come onto my site and look for this, but I like to think that a few dozen times a year, for whatever reason, somebody stumbles into the RTTY Art collection. They might not know that it was transferred by hand 50 or 60 years previously by ham radio folks having a great Sunday evening. They won't know about John's voice. They won't see Don's face. They might not even know what the art's referencing in terms of a pop culture icon now gone or a place that they've never been to. But I'm sure they'll get the same thrill that I got as a teenager, seeing letters and numbers standing back from them, seeing a face or a landscape pop out at you, and realizing the handmade artwork that would cause something like this to be made, shared, and given to the world for free. Thank you so much to Don Royer, WA6PIR, to John Sheetz, K2AGI, and everybody else who was a part of making this thing, and everybody else who played a part in this unique, wonderful, beautiful, timeless medium. This is Jason Scott Talks His Way Out of It. Thanks to Mark Pilgrim, James Bekoyanu, Forrest Fuqua, and the hundreds of other supporters on Patreon and elsewhere who have been supporting me and helping me get out of debt. John Sheetz, during his interview, mentioned one methodology for creating this art that blew me away. Some of these things would look really good. I mean, stuff that was just a little bit beyond the idea that somebody would glance at it and then turn it into these letters and numbers so easily. What he told me was going on was that sometimes people would put photographs or centerfolds or magazine pictures into a printer. They would then put the printer head over each position, look at what was underneath it, and then try to guess the character that was the most dark or light to simulate what was underneath the printer head, and then they would move on to the next one. After they were done with all of that, they would print it out and then refine it. In other words, they were using a printer to do rotoscope artwork of photographs. There's a documentary called Tim's Vermeer that puts forward the idea that using a camera obscura helped some types of Renaissance paintings produce the quality of the artwork, the lighting, and the positioning. That may or may not be true, But there's an entire range of artistic technique out there that uses the real world as a jumping point for creating artwork. And while the methods have varied, the idea is always that adding yourself into the process will produce something that is perhaps more like it than the naked eye would have done, but still, in its own way, given your own personal fingerprint. The show notes for this particular episode will be a pretty large list, but if you're just listening to this without any of that, the two websites to check out are rtty.com and artscene.textfiles.com. Happy viewing.